Dr. Mohammad, Tamim, Professor, Department of Petroleum and Mineral Resources Engineering, Kuwait, and former Special Assistant to the Chief Advisor of the Exchequer Government of Bangladesh, Dr. Mohammad Tamim.
To address that, we have to look into the mandates of SDG, which actually is the first ring is 2030 agenda, that actually talks about ensure access to affordable, reliable, sustainable and modern energy for all. That is the number 7 point of the SDG goal, and that includes energy efficiency improvement, then supporting and more renewable energy is part of and that is to have a sustainable growth. The emphasis has been given on energy efficiency and renewable energy as well. But the important factor is affordability, reliability, sustainability, and energy for all, modern energy. That is the focus of SDG. The government plan is no different. GOP plan and SDG goals are same or very similar. And combining these two, the power system master plan that has been done by JICA, they consider the SDG goals and the government vision that I showed earlier. They came up with 5 objectives and 5 key areas where you need to address immediately and plan for future. And these are the 5 areas and which has merged the two vision, SDG goals and government vision. I will go with each of these one at a time. And the fuel mix optimization, which is very critical and important in the PSMT study, has been done on the basis of these 3 factors: economy, environment, and energy security. And the point, the important factor of the issues that need to be observed is that all these 3 are very competing with each other. If you look at the environmental, their emphasis is 100% environment. They forget about energy security and they forget about economy. But those who are on practical ground, they probably even bother much about the environment. They won't look into the economy. And as a from a national perspective, energy security is equally important. So to optimize all these 3 is very important. And we have to understand the presentation or claims by different people that, you know, this we have Bangladesh is a single product, major product export country. You can see the speed of different manufacturing sector, and 85% of the manufacturing export manufacturing sector is dominated by textile and garments. There are opportunities to diverse. And roadmap have been shown in a JICA study where it shows that in the early 70s we had jute as the major export product, and then from 80s till now is the RMG, and in future they have given some diverse manufacturing high-end, high-value addition products that we will have to embark on to create more jobs. Take the GDP goal beyond 7%. Now, in the 7-5-year plan, 3 major barriers have been identified for the barrier for industrial goal. What are the barriers currently? There's power, transport, and land. One component that has been left out of this major barrier, in my opinion, is human resources that has not been addressed in that plan. I think that needs to be addressed very strongly. So I have added in the fourth factor that is required or that is a barrier right now for growth. Industry worries, the president already talked about their worries. Unreliable wind power right now, short and uncertain gas supply, and gap between promise and performance. So these are the worries of the industries right now. And of course, price unpredictability. That once Because unless you know the price, you cannot plan. And any project that has an uncertain major input of ingredient, that creates a lot of insecurity and uncertainty. And right now, industry is suffering from that. So that needs to be addressed. And to address that, we have to look into the mandates of SDG, which actually is the first ring is 2030 agenda. That actually talks about ensure access to affordable, reliable, sustainable, and modern energy for all. That is the number 7 point of the SDG goal, and that includes energy efficiency improvement, then supporting and more renewable energy is part of and some, that is to have a sustainable growth. The emphasis has been given on energy efficiency and renewable energy as well. But the important factor is affordability, reliability, sustainability, and energy for all, modern energy. That is the focus of SDG. The government plan is no different. GOP plan and SDG goals are same or very similar. And combining these two, the power system master plan that has been done by JICA, they consider the SDG goals and the government vision that I showed earlier. They came up with 5 objectives and 5 key areas where you need to address immediately and plan for future. And these are the 5 areas and which has marked the 2 vision, SDG goals and government vision. I will go with each of these one at a time. And the fuel mix optimization, which is very critical and important in the PSMT study, has been done on the basis of these 3 factors: economy, environment, and energy security. The point, the important factor of the issues that need to be observed is that all these 3 are very competing with each other. If you look at the environmentalists, their emphasis is 100% environment. They forget about energy security and they forget about economy. But those who are on practical ground, they probably even bother much about the environment. They won't look into the economy. And as a national, from a national perspective, energy security is equally important. So to optimize all these 3 is very important. And we have to understand that presentation or changed by different people that, you know, this we have to go this way, that way. The focus has to be optimization of these 3 factors. Now we look into the supply of sustainable primary energy. PE stands for primary energy and the required infrastructure. If you review the 2010 PSMT, there was a power system master plan in 2010 which predicted growth, which predicted supply of primary energy and the kind of power plants that we need to set up. And you can see it's already passed and it was done in 2010. We are in 2017 now. So we can look back and see where we have failed. And you can see that the gas supply has not been up to the mark, what has been asked. And similarly, even local coal supply never met the 1 million threshold in any of the years. So it indicates that as a result, perhaps, we have not been able to achieve those 6 and 7% energy GDP growth in the last 5 years. That could be one of the reasons. I'm not saying that's the only reason, but that could be one of the reasons that we could not supply the primary energy that was required for the growth. The demand assessment. In 2020, PSMP 2010 assessed 17,000 peak demand, but PSMP 2016 said it's about 13,000. And government is planning to install 23,000 megawatts of equivalent, 23 megawatts of productive capacity. And then 2030, the PSMP is saying that 13,000, 16 saying 27,000, and then 40,000 is the government plan. This is something I want you to focus on the left-hand side. PSMP 2010 projection of peak demand, let's say for 2050, was about 10,000 barrels. But if you look at the PDB data, it says 7,800 megawatts. That's real data. The peak demand went up to 7,800. That is a huge discrepancy. The reason is PDB's demand forecast that is being told to us is a fictitious number. It is not a true number. And because of that, they maintain that number on record. Those demands are there. Actual demand was much more. Today they are saying that the demand we are producing 9,000 megawatt, the demand is 9,200 or 8,900 or something, so there is no load shedding. So to hide the load shedding, they are manipulating the data, and that is creating problem for the planners to do the planning in future. So we have to be truthful, so we have to know, tell that what is the real demand, and that can be easily done. Mismatching fuel import infrastructure and generation plan. If you look at the coal plan, there are about 12,000 megawatt of coal generation plan is on the paper or at different stages of approval process. Some of has been already approved, some are under evaluation, some are in the plan. There's 12,000 megawatt. There has been no coal import facility. So if you have huge import-based power plant planning, and if you don't focus on the import part of that, which is facilities of infrastructure, then obviously your own power plant will be sitting there and not focus much. In the same way, the planning about 2,500 megawatt dual fuel. Dual fuels are all diesel and gas, gas and diesel. Right now, 1,700 megawatt of power plant is stranded because of lack of supply of gas. In addition to that, if we have 25,000 megawatt dual fuel, even huge LNG import may not be able to service those plants, and we'll have to depend on different. So this is the status of the coal projects right now. Pyra, we are hoping that Pyra, 1320 megawatt Pyra will come on stream by 2019. And if that 1320 can come by 2019, that will be a huge relief for the government. It is very challenging, very difficult, but I tell you, sticking to a plan helps. Sticking to a plan of fuel mix, kind of what kind of required, the entire system planning, all those kind of things, that helps to avoid some of this mismatch that we have seen. It reduces the uncertainty. At least we all know fuel type right now. Because of the delay of the coal plants, about 3,000 megawatt of new oil-based power plant is being in the process of approval. Opportunities. I have been proposing this for a long time, and I am taking this opportunity to again propose to switch from conventional planning to integrated resource planning. Integrated resource planning focuses on system cost reduction, minimum system cost instead of minimum generation cost. It focuses on distributed system, it focuses on bottom-up approach of prediction. And in 22 states in USA, it is by law that the planners have to use integrated resource plan. Many countries do that formally or informally. We should now look into this, because we have been doing conventional planning. And if you go and look into the integrated resource planning, actually PSMP 2016 took a lot of elements from integrated resource planning in its planning. So I appreciate that. That is relatively a much better plan than any plan we have done in the past. And big problem in terms of talking point, in terms of government planning, is lack of data. Especially consumer data, you don't have much consumer data. So I think a central repository of data is an opportunity right now to develop so that we can easily track the growth path and its requirement. And then gradual transition to a smart. All right, I'll go to the week. Very good news for the government. Crude oil price forecast and LNG price forecast seems to be quite flat. Crude oil lowest rate is 55 by 2020, 55 dollar per barrel to $66 per barrel, and LNG, Japan LNG import is predicted by up to 2023 to be flat at $7, which is very good news for the government because they will have some breathing space with all these oil-based power plants to go into the actual optimum fuel mix. They have some little more time. Current rate of industry, this is the rate, but industry in future price projection, after showing this, I would like to say that in future price projection, industry must be involved in the understanding of supply, planning, and pricing, and how to increase the price gradually so that industry has enough time to prepare and adjust. These are just numbers. This is the LNG price situation. We are talking about affordable pricing. Currently, the weighted average gas price of Petrobangla is $2.20 per 1,000 cubic feet. And if we import at $7, and if the mix is 500 million per day import and 2,700 local supply at $2.20, the resulting price will be $3.23. If it is $8, it will be $3.41. This exercise has been done by Petrobangla. So, weighted average price to take it from $2.20 to $3.40, there will be some price shock, but I think it is doable. Government can do it, increase the price of gas to some extent, so that the import price of LNG, if it is at $8, can be adjusted to the market without much difficulty. Now, price prediction, this I have done an exercise myself. In 2025, if the supply, local supply is 2400 million, that is the total requirement, about 4800 million cubic feet per day. And import is 2400 at $10, then the resulting price will be $6 per MCA by 2025. And by 2030, the local supply is 1200, the import is 4000, and the resulting price would be $8, assuming $10 LNG price and $2 local price. And the electricity tariff, it has been shown in PSP 2015 that by 2041 the tariff will be about 30 Dhaka per kilowatt. Fuel mix is very important, and one thing to be noted that by 2041, according to the present plan, more than 90% of the energy for electricity production will be imported. Opportunities in pricing. Historical low fossil fuel price allows the GOB to adjust the local fuel price to international price. This I have been asking for a long time. Let the local price come to the international price and be through a transparent formula. Let it be the let the price, so that the subsidy issue will be gone forever. If they want to give subsidy, they can give direct subsidy in future if the price goes up. But fossil fuel price is not going to go up very soon, so this is a good opportunity for government to adjust the price to the local price. It also allows the government to predict future gas price and electricity price for the industry and general public with confidence. Because of this price, because oil is going to play a big role, I think government should come up with a prediction, price prediction for the next 5 years or next 10 years, so that the industry feels at ease and they can plan. It's very important for them to feel at ease and plan. Renewable, number of studies has been done. Wind energy has minimal to zero opportunity because there is no wind source. Lot of people say a lot of things. Please verify yourself and find out whether there is a company. Current technology in Bangladesh requires 300 to 400 acres, 350 to 400 acres land for 100 megawatts solar panel. So land is a big problem, this restriction, especially in getting in one chunk. So the dream of having 10,000 megawatt power plant, solar power plants in Bangladesh, I'm not very convinced on that. Biogas is a good option for quality energy for the rural area. Government can give subsidy and help it. And rooftop solar should be promoted. That has huge potential and opportunity, rooftop solar. And government should really come up with the policy so that they can focus on rooftop solar. This is a study done by Sweda and World Bank in 2015. And the maximum potential of renewable is shown here, 3,600, including all sources. So, you hear all sides, kind of competing numbers depending on individual agenda. So we have to be realistic. This is based on ground reality. Maybe we can add another 1,500 and say 5,000 total opportunity, or maybe 10,000, but not 20,000, 30,000. I don't see that in my position. Our opportunity actually lies in the efficiency. If we go for efficiency improvement, just 1% per year for the next 20 years, we have opportunity to reduce the demand by more than 20%. And that is real. I have already discussed the last point here. I want to discuss is that we should try to maximize import from neighboring countries. That is a fantastic renewable energy opportunity for me. We don't have to use the land, we don't have to invest, we have no pollution, we are just getting finished electricity from neighbors. That is adding to renewable procurement. So, government has done a very good job securing 600, they are going for another 500, and the plan is to get 9,000 from neighbors by 2040. And that's a great opportunity. I'm living in the interior here outside my discussion. If the panels or the discussion want to discuss nuclear, they can discuss. And the last but not the least is the human resource development. Scarcity of need and job level challenges with technical background, shortage of skilled technical work. Today, just today in Kothamalam, I saw that in government sector itself, 36 lakh, 3.6 million skilled worker division. 3.6 million in garment sector, where we are the second leader in the world, skill labor. So how will we achieve 7-8% growth unless we have human resource development? And human resource development needs a national plan itself with ministerial supervision is more than appropriate. It's required. We have to focus on human resource development. We can talk about our human resource availability. We can talk about the quality of our human resources, but that needs to be really understood, discussed, and focused on to improve. So I cannot give any more emphasis than human resource development for achieving our, because it is the human that converts resources to wealth. Resources to wealth does not get converted by itself. You require human intervention. And if you don't have quality human resources, nothing will happen. We would not go anywhere. And that was it. Thank you.